that Antoine will present today. It's your turn.
Thank you very much, François, and thanks for this invitation and for giving me the opportunity to present myself. So maybe before going to this, as you said, exotic materials, actually this word, I just would like maybe to take the opportunity to introduce myself. So indeed, I did my, from 2013 to 2016, I did my PhD under the supervision, under the nice guidance of Rémi Kelly and Nicolas. And at this time, I was looking at how complex fluid, how we can force complex fluid to spread onto a surface. So I was using a really simple setup, as said François, actually, just let's say a blade, a knife. And the question was how much quantity of mayonnaise or emulsion, let's say, you can untrade onto a surface. And when you do actually such experiments, actually, it's not that trivial because, well, what you can see is like just sorry for that. Maybe just to be a bit more clear, what you're gonna see just like look from below, underneath the scraper, okay, of the liquid, while it's like coating is forced to spread onto a glass of a plate actually, a glass plate. So in the case of emulsion, what we observe like a kind of a really rich phenomenology. I'm just going to show you this video. What we are seeing here is like you're forcing the emulsion to spread onto the glass plate, huh? And the scraper is there. You're pulling onto your substrate, or you, let's say, you're pulling onto your knife. And instead of nicely coating your emulsion onto your substrate, while your emulsion start to go into a meniscus and start to destabilize after a certain distance. So we were looking at actually why, trying to understand why these things was happening. So probably lots of evaporation are occurring during the experiment, and that's why this thing is like starting to destabilize. We also moved to another kind of complex fluids, polymer solution at molecular weight. And it was a kind of the same story actually. If you try to coat it onto a substrate, instead of nicely, homogeneously untraining onto a plate, what you can see on this upper right video is like the contact line is also like really unstable. Huh? And instead of homogeneously coat your plate, as one would maybe expect, the contact line actually is really unstable and form like kind of fingers with a certain wavelength and with a typical shape. Huh? And so what we did is like we try to understand what was happening, and actually what you can do is like you can also, with a simple experiment, you can easily increase the speed of spreading, and you can see that at higher speed you also form this kind of figure. So we were trying to understand what was happening in this kind of instability. Okay, then during my PhD, I did also more maybe exotic stuff. So I was also playing with another kind of material. So what you can see here is like it's called now X-Bux. So it's a little toy that is able to vibrate, and by vibrating, it's able to propel itself on a this is my desk, so just on a flat surface. So typically, this is the size of the system, a few centimeters. Okay. And so what we did with it, we put them into like an arena, a fixed circular arena. And what we observe mainly is that if you increase the concentration of these small guys, what you can see is that for a given concentration, for critical concentration, they start to, in the center, you observe mostly what is the gas of these particles, while on the boundary, you see like it's forming lots of aggregates, actually. So we try to understand why this thing was happening for certain conditions, for this curvature and for this concentration of particles. And what the idea is, like at the end, you can use the formation of these aggregates to eventually do more smarter stuff, and drive like free arena, what is a free arena, and do like more complex motions. So, for instance, like these mindless robots, when you form aggregates, they are able to achieve more complex tasks, as we're seeing here. They're able eventually to go through small constriction and do lessons. So we are really playing with a. With this guy at the end of my thesis. Okay, then I moved to Amsterdam to do a postdoc. So nice picture of Daniel. And I basically spent my two first year of postdoc in Amsterdam to look at what was happening when the guy is like sneezing, for instance. And so you take your fast camera, and this is typically what you can see. So this is definitely a corona experiment, where you want to understand what's happening when someone is like sneezing. And what you can see is like, of course, saliva is something a bit more complicated than water. It's like a viscoelastic solution. And sometimes what you, when you know, like saliva is like expelled from the from your mouth or your, I don't know, your nose maybe, it can form like some pearls. Huh? And so basically, this is also something that you can observe yourself without your mask. You put some saliva into your two fingers and you try, you know, to just squeeze out this saliva. And by doing that, you can see like formation of three small bits on this filament. And so we were trying to understand that. And yeah, actually, we did like, well, we bring some, I think, nice contribution to the understanding of this process. Okay, so just to end up maybe on what I was doing this last few years in Amsterdam, we were also like interested in another kind of project. Okay, so we were trying to answer to this question. So if you consider a bouillon soup, something kind of fully liquid, something really drinkable. So at the first, you know, at the first soup, what you can think is, okay, a soup is like a liquid, a bouillon soup is like something really, really liquid. So in terms of viscosity, it's not that different. Huh? And so the question is, can we feel a difference? I mean, when if I ask you, I prepare different kind of bouillon soup, you know, still very, very dilute system. Huh? If I ask you, can you feel a difference? I think the answer will be yes. I will show you afterwards. But you can feel a difference, a slight difference in terms of viscosity. But does physics can help us to understand how we feel this difference? Huh? So, well, I do like this movie from Disney, Avatar 2. So he's really able, you know, by combining nice product together to really feel a difference. And I think that was the main idea of this project. So, well, this is what it looks like, something really spoonable, something really drinkable. You can play with a different ingredients into the soups. Huh? You can use some thickener, like xanthan gum, things like this, some starch. And well, just to give you an overview of what kind of shear viscosity we brought, soups are commercial samples. Just to be clear, they are sold by Unilever. Huh? And so the question is, yeah, can we use this, this experimental lab measurements and try to connect it to some psychological measurements? So, so what we were thinking is like, okay, so finally your mouse is nothing else than, you know, just two plates. So finally your mouse is maybe a really good barometer. So your palate is like, you know, a thin plate and your tongue the same thing. And what you're doing when you're swallowing your bouillon soup is just that actually you're squeezing it, you're squeezing your liquid bouillon and when you're shearing. And so if you consider such simple approximation, maybe you can extract, I mean, you can extract the stress, which is undergoing onto your tongue, okay? So it's not that trivial because of course, I mean, this stress depends on the rheology parameter, some psychophysical things, but maybe you can do this simple exercise, you know? And at the end, what is really interesting is, okay, it looks like a complicated formula, but at the end you have some psychophysical input to put into it, because you have a normal force. I mean, this is how much force you exerting onto your bouillon soup, how your tongue is squeezing your liquid, right? Also, you have the initial condition, so the spreading of the liquid bouillon onto your tongue at the initial stage, things like this. And at the end, if you know this psychophysical inputs, this stress is only dependent on the rheology parameter of your bouillon soup. So it's really nice because at the end you have kind of a model where if you just vary the ingredients into your bouillon soup, you are able to predict eventually the stress which is undergoing onto your tongue. Okay? And so the main interesting part, you know, the conclusion kind of this really recent thing that I did in Amsterdam is like I had access to the score made by some panelists of people in Unilever, so they were able, you know, like to say, okay, this bouillon soup is more or less thick, you know. And actually, what you can already notice is like, well, the distribution curve are kind of interesting, right? I mean, it's like, it's saying that finally it's not that broad. Huh? And at the end, if you plot on this, well, what you can see here, I just plotted the subjective index, so the average value of these things, huh? Or people have assessed the thickness of this Bouillon as a function of this, you know, calculated stress. And what you do see is like there is strong correlation with the logarithms of this stress. So this thing seems to say that how you perceive a liquid is sensitive to the logarithms of the stimulus, of the stress on your tongue. And so, well, maybe it's not that surprising because, I mean, how all of our organs are kind of, you know, logarithm has never been shown in that way. So I think it's kind of a funny, you know, experiment. Well, okay. So this was like kind of my background. Now I would like to talk about something a bit different, actually, about more exotic fluid, which is made of worms. So what you can see here is like, actually an assembly, a collection of these worms, because they are spontaneously wants to aggregate together. So let's have a look into more details of what is this system. So what you're seeing here is like this a small worm, which is called tubifex worm. It's also known as sludge worm because these guys are in a natural environment. They are living in sewers, or in a really quiet or calm canals. So they are living in fresh water. But actually, you can easily form them in a good pasture. Actually, they are used to feed fishes because they are full of proteins. And what you can see is they are made of hemoglobin, small segments. So this red segment, so they are carrying indeed blood. And voila, when I have seen that actually, voila, I mean, every polymerist guy would say, oh, okay, it looks really like a polymer actually, because you see, like it's made maybe of small segments, so you can eventually make this analogy with some spacist techniques, you know, it's also fluctuating a lot. And so, when I saw that, I was like, okay, this guy is like really close to a polymer. Maybe we have a nice system to make analogy with active polymers. You know? And actually, I mean, I just like put that into parallel. But if you do some simulation of a regular polymer, I mean, the parallel is kind of obvious, right? It's qualitatively, it's like really close, I think. Okay, so the idea of this talk, of this surface, is to see how far we can push, you know, the analogy between something which is completely non-thermal. This is a big, it can make like a few centimeters, so it's completely non-thermal, to something which is that we really know, you know, a regular polymer. Okay, so just to come back to what does exist in literature or not. Actually, people are struggling a lot to try to synthesize active filaments. And what is mostly done is like simulation by different groups in Germany, mostly in the group of Gomper and Winkler. And actually, we have maybe I have one example in mind. So this thing is actually made in Amsterdam as well by the group of Peter Shaw, where they are using patchy particles. And by controlling the interaction between the patchy particles, they are able to synthesize such kind of chain. But the thing is, like, if one wants to perform rheology on such system, you see that you're going to be really limited because first it's really hard to manipulate, really hard to synthesize, and you need a lot of quantity to be able to, you know, extract a macroscopic value of the thing. Right. So what has been done already mostly? Here I'm showing you another kind of active system, which is more like an active colloid. People have mostly worked on active organisms such as algae or E. coli. But still, in this kind of experiment, what you can see here, actually, play it again. What you can see here is like these algae are moving around, you know, and they are typically trying to measure the rheology of such system. But you can already see that. This kind of system are really, really diluted. So if one wants to perform a rheology on the system, I think you're going to be really limited by what's going to be the output of this measurement. And actually, if you look back to this classical paper, which are already kind of old, 10 years ago. So it has been mostly done in PME mesh, if I remember correctly, in Grenoble, maybe. Well, they perform some regime measurements on this active suspension. And what you can already see, like if you want to observe the shear thinning or shear thinning, perhaps it is, but there is a really small effect. Okay. Mostly what's doing is like increasing the viscosity, but you don't really see really well, or you don't have like a really important effect, massive effect of the on the shear thinning or shear thinning. So what I want to do now is try to use our, let's say, our system and try to see, yeah, how far we can do that, what can we do with our system. And actually, one nice feature of the system is like, now I have a batch that I bring from my nice pet shop in Amsterdam. I just put it in water, in fresh water, and I just visualize it from the top, okay? And what the system is doing spontaneously is trying to aggregate. I don't know if you've seen that, but I can move a bit, like maybe a bit further into the video. But actually, it's a long, kind of a long video, and the time scale is kind of long to completely aggregate. But you see that we started mostly with an homogeneous system, and then the system starts really, like, you know, to go to one single phase. Huh? So I think every physicist will say, "Oh, phase separation is occurring. We have phase separation of active polymers." Okay, but my point is to say, okay, we have a system who wants to aggregate, you know, and here it's really untangled, right? So if we want to perform a rheology, and maybe we will find some common features with a regular polymer. Okay, so just, well, maybe it's an answer for you, but just a quick reminder of what we would like to observe. Well, we have something which is kind of really untangled as a polymer solution is doing. So at low deformation rate, you know what you expect is to observe a Newtonian plateau. When you start to deform the system, you enter into a region where you call a shear thinning region, where you start to actually align and deform your polymer, right? And well, if you increase enough your shear rate and your deformation rate, maybe your system will be completely aligned, and then you tend to this second Newtonian plateau. Huh? Okay, so let's do that with our polymer active polymer solution, our exotic material. So we design a specific cell for that, right? So by just, you know, measuring the mass of worms that we are putting into the water, you are able to change the concentration. Why a transparent beaker around it? It's just because we wanted to be sure, like while we are sharing our samples, the samples is as much possible homogeneous. Okay. Also, we wanted to check that we are correctly sharing our samples, so we perform some PID measurements, things like this, to be, you know, just to double check if the shear rate was okay. Okay, and maybe just for the detail, well, it looks like this on a side view. Okay, so we have our sample into our cell. We made like some, you know, pyramidal teeth like this, because well, we wanted to be sure that, again, that we are at least like showing correctly our samples. Huh? So this size is mostly, I mean, the width of one of our worms, half a millimeter. Okay, so just to be clear, this gap is like a few centimeters, huh? The size of these guys is half of a millimeter. So the width of this guy is half a millimeter. So we have many. Well, we are not like sharing just one singular, element into our cells. And because, well, you know, like preferees are always asking, yeah, but do you have like some finite elements, things like this? But it's a really fair question, and maybe there are some effects at the end. Okay, so let's perform a first version for given concentration. So if I take myself a picture of myself from the top, it looks like this. Okay, I put in some warmth to my water, and now I'm sharing. And what you can already see is like, I mean, well, it's pretty clear, right? I mean, you have a strong shear thinning effect. Huh? And this thing, well, we can fit by just a simple model, the cross model, and extract the plateau value at low deformation rate, or in the limit of, yeah.
So just in the dilute case, how reproducible it is when you're dilute? Because they kind of looks like they can be...
So, exactly. So for dilute concentration, it's really tricky. So what I always done for one given concentration is I do like a we call that a ramp from a low value of charrette to high value, and then I go back to this value. And these things are, you know, they are perfectly superimposing. So for, I would say that for a given concentration and for a given preparation, initial preparation, it's really important. It's really predictable. If you prepare your sample with another state, you know, for sure maybe the concentration will be a bit different. Okay. But well, this thing we'll go through that. But for higher concentration, we don't have the same problem because you will see that the system is really entangled and that there is not much space, you know, to have different initial states. Does it answer the question? Yes. Yeah. Good. Well, so. No, what we, yeah, okay, so sorry, just to go back to this, well, to this simple part, you know, cross model, you can extract, of course, you know, like the viscosity at low deformation rate, you can extract the reaction time of the solution, and well, eventually, you know, how strong is the shear thinning exponent, alpha. Right. So what we did is like, well, just increasing, you know, the concentration of our worms into the water, and what you see is like, yeah, okay, shifting up this curve to higher value, and okay, so I guess, you know, like this answer maybe more or less the question, but for higher concentration, we are really in this entangled state. That's the main point on that. So what I just checked is like how this initial viscosity at low deformation rate depends on the concentration of my worms, my cell. And what you do see actually, even if we believe, you know, that the system is kind of entangled naturally, actually the entanglement is quite low. So the scaling, well, generally, you know, like you expect to have a scaling in one, so a linear relationship for low concentration. This is like a Stokes-Einstein increase of the viscosity. But when you start to increase a lot your system, you expect at least to have, like, at least for a regular polymer solution, depending on the theory, that the exponent is at least 3 or a bit more. And we do have something in between. Well, obviously, we don't understand why. Maybe it's because the worms are not that entangled. You know, the interaction between the worms are not that strong. And well, maybe they are also sleeping, things like this. But I mean, this is definitely something that we would like to understand by, you know, performing a simulation or things like this. Right. So it was one aspect. Now I'm bringing an interesting feature aspect of this system is that we can control the activity of these guys. So how do we control the activity of this guy? So what you see is already what I showed you. You know, you have a certain one. It's living at in fresh water for a given temperature. So the temperature of water, this is the temperature of the water, not the temperature of the worms. And some people are always asking, but is the effective temperature of your active system? No, just the temperature of the ambient ambient environment, okay? But a nice thing that you can do is, like, for instance, bring this nice drink from directly from Amsterdam. Actually, Arjen is doing that for us. You just add some tiny amount of alcohol into the water, and you can make it completely drunk. Okay, and so if I compare both, no, you see that, well, no, the guy is much slower, as you do actually. Drink a few beers, I think you get same kind of thing. Actually, it's not violent for him because if I put it back into the fresh water after 15-20 minutes, he can recover, he can sober up. So I wish, you know, if I would take a shower, I could sober up as the guy does. Another way to control its activity. It's like by playing with the temperature of the environment. If I decrease the temperature, if I increase it slightly, so the range are limited because, well, you know, it cannot survive above 35 degrees. It's carrying blood cell as we do, so you cannot increase the temperature more than 35. But if I increase the temperature to 35, it's going to be more active. And if I decrease the temperature, it's like the activity is decreasing as well. Okay, so two ways of controlling the activity. Well, this thing is a bit violent, you know, it's completely red, but you can play a bit more by playing with the temperature. Right, so let's see what's happening. So to measure the activity, we are, you can, you know, apply the same kind of physical tool that you would do for regular polymer solution. You can measure, you know, just by analyzing the shape of this guy, you can, you know, measure the end-to-end distance, so you can track that, you can track the contour, you can also like, you know, measure persistent length by dividing by some segment. So there, it's kind of a rich, you know, things that you can do on this system, right? Okay. So now, if I measure this end-to-end distance as a function of its activity, so what you're seeing here is like the fluctuation of this end-to-end distance as a function of time. So you see that for a given activity, so this thing was at, let's say, at ambient temperature, you see that well, the guy is flapping like this, it's wiggling, it's flapping, and so basically it's just like, you know, like moving like this. Well, this thing is just, you know, it's relatively to zero because I just subtracted the average value of the end-to-end distance. So this is just a fluctuation, okay, around the average value of the end-to-end distance. So now I put this guy, I make it like a drag. Yes, sorry. Okay, before that, what one could do is like extract the correlation time of this function, okay? And from that, so well, we decided that we define this correlation, the characteristic time of our worms, as let's say when we lost half of this correlation, okay? Just as a definition, I could have done something else, but then you can extract the correlation time of a singular worms, okay? So this is what I will call the microscopic time or two worms in the next slide. Okay, so let's make it drunk. So you see on the same sequence of time, well, the guy moved much less, and I think it's really observable on the same thread, right? And it's moving much less. And of course, I mean, the correlation time is no increasing. If I take it at 50%, it has increased. Maybe it's a bit misleading, but well, it's like in a log, it's not that much math about any here, but I mean, the time is changing quite a lot. Okay. And now the question is, how does this activity could affect the rheologies that we are measuring? Okay, so we have two other things that we'd like to discuss. So this shear thinning exponent and this reaction time. Okay, so the macroscopic ones that we measure with the remeter, so the kind of average value of our system. Okay, so first about this shear thinning exponent. We did observe like a slight effect of this activity on the shear thinning exponent. Okay, so when actually the worm is really drunk or not active at all, the shear thinning exponent is really strong. Okay, it's really close to -1. When you increase its activity, the shear thinning exponent is decreasing to something around 0.7. So we interpreted it that. I mean, what it means is like when the worm is more active, it's harder for us to force them to align to the flow. They oppose to the flow that we are imposing into our register. Okay. But there is another feature. It's like we're going to discuss the effect of activity on this reaction time, the macroscopic reaction time that we are measuring in ourselves, and compare it eventually to the microscopic time that I measured before from taking a picture. And this is what generally people are doing when you're doing polymer rheology. So what I reported here is like the measurement of this average value of this reaction time, Torio, from the feed, okay, that I measure in rheology, versus this macroscopic, let's say, reaction time that I measure from the correlation function of this end-to-end distance. Okay, so again, when you decrease the activity, this microscopic time is getting larger. And actually, this is also what we observed by measuring the viscosity, the flow curve of this form. So one who could not is like, I mean, there is a strong correlation, which is, I mean, not that surprising, which is nice, actually, it's nice features. But actually, the correspondence is kind of a bit weird because there are at least a factor of 100 between the two. So we know, like, you know, from polymer solution that generally what you probe into a cell is like an average value. So generally, you probe, I mean, you're more sensitive to longer time scale. You're always limited by longer time scale. So generally, in polymer solution, a maximum of factor of 10 is measured between these things and these things. But here we still have like something 100, and so maybe it comes from the fact that, you know, we have a system which is really poly dispersed. You have, I don't know, it's an active system, so maybe much more complicated than a regular polymer solution. And well, it's I think it's interesting to try to investigate and try to understand better why does it come from, or where does it come from. Okay, so these things end up a bit on this zoology discussion, on this zoology part. Am I stealing?
Vas-y.
I have a short other second story. I hope it's gonna work. Yes. Okay.
T'as tout compris.
Duplicate slide.
Ouais.
It's okay.
Oui.
Great. So second part of this story is this I think nice system is like if you remember we observed like from the top with this simple experiment. That the system wants always to spontaneously aggregate. So if you look at these forms on this right part, they will want to go to these blobs. They want to form one single cluster. So the second part of this talk is can we try to understand how it's happening? Okay. Well, I already mentioned that it looks like the phase separation. Huh? So, well, you do know that, if you like two materials A and B, like growing in time as a polymer solution is, you would observe some coarsening, huh? And this thing is due to the difference of chemical potential between the systems, and what we call like Laplace pressure, because there is a surface tension in the system. The smaller droplets are going into the bigger droplets to decrease, this pressure. Huh? Okay, so. I think Lifshitz and Schlosser were the first, so I just reopened this old book, and extract what is the dynamic of such phase separation for a regular polymer solution. And generally, what is reported, that people are doing light diffusion onto the system, and light scattering, and measuring how the wave vector is growing in time, how the main size of the system is growing in time. And generally, what they report is the main size of the system is growing as one third. In time, huh? With importantly in the prefactor capturing all the physics. I mean, you need the surface tension and the diffusion coefficient, and those are the initial conditions, let's say. And by playing with by playing with the temperature, apparently you can collapse all the curve together. Huh? So the question now is, okay, could we? I mean, if I measure the dynamic into our system in the same way, is there like first a surface tension and a diffusion coefficient in our system, and can I eventually measure such dynamics? Okay, naively from what we know from polymer solutions. Okay, so now I'm just showing a picture from the side of my system. So in time, actually, if I wait enough, they're forming this kind of blobs. Huh? So I just want for you to focus on this thing. It's making a certain size that I took like this crew here to compare the blob size. So it's a small one. A certain quantity of warps. And what I try to do, if I do just a simple image analysis, I can extract one single radius for that. It's almost perfectly spherical, Now what I'm doing is like I'm increasing much more the number of warps into my blob. So I just add some warps into my blobs. So I mean, I don't want you to be confused, but I mean, this thing is much bigger because, these things appear much smaller into the spectra. So now what you do see is like exactly what one would expect with a liquid droplet, right? If I add more and more volume to my droplet, almost, you start to see the effect of gravity. Huh? This thing is flattening out by the effect of gravity. And so now maybe you start to, you can extract two radius of curvature, eventually, measure capillary length and extract the surface tension. Okay. So maybe this system, we can explain it, try to extract some features with the surface tension, things like this. Another ingredient is a diffusion coefficient. If I want to understand the dynamic, it's like I told you, like the phase separation is also controlled by the diffusion through the material A, for instance. And so what I did here, I just report, you know, like the motion from the top, you know, the x, y plan of a single one for different activity, for different temperature. And what you do see is like this guy wants to explore. If I track the center of mass of this guy in time, it's like a, like, you know, like a chaotic motion, like this, you know, random motion. And well, this but just by increasing the temperature, what we do observe is like the guy is flowing much more. So it seems to say that, well, maybe, you know, we can extract some diffusion coefficient. And indeed, if I report the MSD note of multiple ones for different activity, you do see that. So color code is the same. The light blue is like for low activity, for the darker blue is like for higher activity. You do see that, you know, you can the diffusion coefficient is increasing. So I just average like a different ones, the diffusion coefficient of different ones. Maybe, you know, like all these ones are different. I mean, the warm bar reflects finally the polydispersity of our system. I think bigger warm are like moving a bit faster. But still, I mean, on average, I mean, you do see that the diffusion coefficient is increasing as a function of the activity or the temperature. Okay, so it's nice. We have a kind of surface tension and maybe a diffusion coefficient. So let's do, you know, the model experiment. So you place all your antipolymer into a large tank. So I did this experiment actually in a aquarium of 50 per 50 centimeters. So here it's just like, you know, just a piece of this aquarium. And well, initially, you know, you prepare your initial states. So you take your fork and you try to homogenize as much as possible the system. And let's see what's happening. Well, you already have you know, some taste of that initially before, because I showed you what's happening. But I mean, indeed, what you can see is like, I mean, the worms are like forming these clusters that are growing more and more in time. I do like this nice pattern, and so with some, you know, size. And so if I wait enough at the end, I will get one single, you know, blob. So okay, of course I cannot do scattering, light scattering on such big worms, but what I can do is, you know, like just walk in the Fourier space and try to extract, you know, how the main side of the domain is growing in time. Actually, what I do measure for the different activities, so still the same color code, low activity to higher activity, is still, I mean, this one third power seems to still hold on our system. Well, if you look at the time scale, I mean, you know, it's like a few hours of experiment, at least something close to 100. Well, same thing. I mean, if I do exactly as this graph from John's book, you know, this Lipschitz filter for measurement, if you just multiply by the diffusion coefficient that I initially showed you, if just before, so the diffusion coefficient depends on, you know, on the temperature. So this one has one diffusion coefficient, this one another, and so on. Well, actually, it can collapse all the curves. So it means that, you know, I mean, the initial dynamic is set by the diffusion, how fast these guys are moving to see each other. Okay, it's nice. I mean, till now we have the feeling that okay, one third is, it looked like exactly like a regular polymer solution, but I mean, how is it possible? So actually, if you pay attention at what it's really happening, the physics is completely different. It couldn't be, you know, like diffusion of one block to another one, where the worms are moving from one to another. What we do see instead, it's like actually the blobs are diffusing themselves, are moving themselves, and then are coalescing together. Okay, so the physics is, well, completely different. Actually, it's not diffusion. I mean, it's not diffusion of worms, but more like coalescence of these blobs together. Okay, so So what you can do is like it's indeed measure as well the diffusion of one blob, and actually. This gives this kind of result. Experimentally, we did observe that the diffusion coefficient of a blob of different size are always the same. So this, the diffusion of this guy doesn't depend on its size. Okay. While just to make as a reminder, you know, the diffusion coefficient which is expected in this kind of Lipschitz filter, and it's like a Stokenstein law, where you do expect that, well, the diffusion coefficient should be inversely dependent of its radius, of its size. Okay, yeah.
So it can connect it. So here the it doesn't depend on the blob size, but does it still depend on the temperature? So is it set by the diffusion? Okay.
Yeah, exactly. So we have some, well, if we want to explain, you know, like the diffusion coefficient constant, we have some scaling argument, but I'm not going to bother you with that. And actually, we didn't check that experimentally yet. We do believe that actually this diffusion of the blob comes from the fact that only the warmth on the surface and not into the bulk are contributing to the motion. Okay, so well, just maybe to give you some maybe indication, there's still something that we like to check experimentally. But if we consider that the warmth has a thrust of like on average of F0, and the RMS of the value is the square root of the number of warmths, so you know, if we are saying that it's only the surface, it should only depend on its size. Okay, and you just, you know, balance that with some drags, and then you can maybe expect that the diffusion coefficient is indeed not dependent on the on its radius. But again, it's still something that we would like to check. Okay, so I just careful because it doesn't explain yet what is a regime that we observe. So I just you know, run some really simple basic simulation. If you consider in one case, on the F case, that the diffusion coefficient should be this Tokachian law, dependently in the inverse of the radius, well, you do see that it's much lower while the diffusion coefficient is constant. I mean, well, it makes sense, right? As soon as the thing is always moving at the same at the same speed, let's say, they are coalescing much faster. So what does it give in terms of dynamic in both cases? So in blue, this is a case where the diffusion coefficient is constant. And then what you do already see is like you refine this 1/3 power. So these are the results from the simulation. Compared to the case where the diffusion coefficient of the blob is inversely proportional to the to its size, which is much lower. And well, just to as a reminder, this is what we found experimentally. So I mean, the noise is not that much surprise. Guy are just growing because they are seeing each other, they are coalescing, and then they're forming one blob due to coalescence, but not, you know, if it's just the last. Right, this concludes a bit. Well, this second story. Maybe I can take question. And before that, I would like just to thank well, my two supervisors in Amsterdam, Daniel and Sandra, which gave me like all the freedom that that I have at this moment in the lab. So it's really nice. And also like to thank these fantastic students, Tess, who's performing other experiments with this worms. I just finished on that. This is really something which is ongoing, but I think it's a kind of really cool things. The system is kind of really polydispersed. When you buy it in the pet shop, you know, you have longer worms because they are, you know, we don't perfectly control the edge and things like this. So it's really polydispersed system. And so the idea is that we would like to, you know, to try to solve them by size, but also by activity. So this is a question that we like to ask. And so we try to, yeah, to use some techniques from the chemist, which are actually using hydrodynamic chromatography to source polymer of different size, and it's based just on the Poiseuille flow. You know, like well, on average, you know, the gyration radius of a bigger polymer is much larger. So on average, it's seeing, you know, a flow which is faster. So what you expect is if you place different polymer of different size, you expect that the larger gets sooner at the end of the column. Okay. Well, you can do actually Poiseuille flow. I mean, they also use this vacuum column because we have like, you know, a series of these guys, and it's more much more efficient to solve them. And so what we did actually, and I just like leave this video for the end of this presentation, but then we try to do this packed column, you know, and place the worm at the entrance of this channel and impose a flow from the left to the right. Okay. And in this channel, there are drugs which are drunk and the other which are completely sober. And this is just the first results from a few weeks ago, but it's kind of amazing because, well, you know, we are, I mean, the time for drunk worms to get out of this geometry is much larger than for worms which are much more active. So it means that with such experiments, we are eventually able to sort the worms at different activities. So it's kind of, you know, kind of fun. And so what you do see here is that these worms are completely dry. These worms are like completely sober, and they get sooner out of the charm. Yeah, and I think this is ending my presentation. And well, I can take any question, and thanks you for your attention.
Thank you very much for plan. So we are